Thank you everyone for coming. We'll go ahead and get started. My pleasure to welcome you to our meeting tonight. We're going to talk about council roles and government ethics. I wanted to take a minute to introduce our speaker, Sean O'Day. Sean received his bachelor's in arts in geography and natural resource management, his juris doctorate from Lewis and Clark Law School, and attended the United States Army Command and General Staff College. Sean spent almost 4 years as the deputy city manager for the city of Salem, served almost 6 years as the general counsel for the League of Oregon Cities, and is currently the executive director of the Midland Valley Council of Governments, our CAR. He serves as lieutenant colonel of the United States Army Reserves, as a team chief of an international and operational law team. Sean was recently appointed by the governor and confirmed by the Senate to serve on the Oregon's Ethics Commission. So please welcome Sean O'Day.
Thank you, Keith. Of all the introductions I've ever had, that one is definitely the most recent. So I appreciate it. Thank you everybody for having me here tonight. And thank you, Keith, for that introduction. It gives you a little bit of sense of what I have done and why Keith and the mayor asked me to come speak tonight on these issues related to local government authorities. Where do cities get their authorities to act? What are the limitations on those authorities? And where do elected officials, by extension, get their authority to act? And what are some of those limitations, particularly in the area of ethics? This is our agenda for tonight. I think we've got about an hour or so, depending upon how long your attention spans last and how quickly I can move through the material. But what I'd like to do is start out with a little bit of introductions. Keith told you a little bit about myself. I'll share a little bit more here in a moment. But I'd like to just quickly go around the room and get a sense of who you are, what your role is, and why it is you're here. I think I overheard at the very beginning we might have a couple of candidates for local office here. And I got to tell you, my hat's off to you. My hat's also off to those who are currently serving. And I just want to give a fair warning. I've only had one person, resign from public office as a result of my lectures. And the reason for that, and you kind of chuckle, but those of you who are in office already know, I am known for saying that local government is one of the most highly regulated activities in America today. If you're a small business owner, you think of all those labor laws, environmental laws, wage and hour laws that apply to you, well, that also applies to local governments. And on top of all of those laws that every business in America has to comply with, including your city government, we have a whole host of other laws that are specific and unique just to cities. Public records law, public meetings law, and we'll be talking about one of those bodies of law tonight, ethics. And literally, I did have somebody at the end of one of these presentations say, you know what, it is just too much and it's not for me, which was not necessarily my intent. I will tell you that this body of law is easy to comply with. And the good news is, if you remember nothing else from my presentation tonight, just remember this, you've got resources. You've got resources in your city managers, you've got resources in your city attorney, you also have a resource in me at the Council of Governments. We'll talk a little bit more about what the Council of Governments is and the type of resources we can provide to you here in a moment. But again, what I'd like to do is go ahead and start. We'll start with you, sir. If you can just tell me your name and your position or on the city, if you're with the city council, or why is it that you're here?
My name is Ralph Lewis. I am a candidate for city council in Staten. I am currently on the Planning Commission. I've been on and off the Planning Commission since 1998. I was on the city council a couple of years ago.
Great.
And hope to get back.
Excellent, excellent. Also, if you want to add, it's completely optional, what you're kind of hoping to get out of tonight, because that'll help me tailor my remarks to what it is that you're all interested in.
I'm not sure what I'm supposed to get out of it.
But you'll get something out of it.
I'm open.
All right, good. At least free coffee and cookies, although I don't see any coffee or cookies tonight, so I guess we've let you down already. Sir?
My name is Scott. I live in Hollinsville. I'm currently a member of the Oregon National Guard, a full-time technician. I'm just here for information on what it takes to be a city councilor.
Excellent. Excellent. So what unit are you with?
I am with JVHQ.
Okay, great. Do I look familiar to you?
No, I'm in the Coleman team.
Oh, okay. So I used to be in the JAG office before I moved to the Army Reserve. So. Great. Excellent. That means you've never been in trouble. That's a good thing. You, sir.
Hi, Mark Bronquist, current city councilor. Parks liaison, school district liaison for the council. former member of the Parks Board, former vice chair of the Parks Board, former planning commission member, and a few other things.
That's great. It's quite a resume. And what are you hoping to get out of tonight?
Well, you're highly recommended. I look forward to learning a lot from you.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Steve Poison. I'm with Revitalize Downtown Staten and the Brown House, and I'm just here to get information.
Excellent. Excellent.
I'm Jane Poison. I came with Steve. I have a family history of national government. My grandfather was in Congress for 20 years when it was good to be in Congress. And two of my cousins are both in state legislatures, and I know nothing about local government in terms of how it's governed. So I'm really interested in what you have to say.
Great, great. Well, if you enjoyed civics in elementary school or in high school, you're going to love tonight. I guarantee. If you didn't care for that so much, I'm going to do my best to keep it interesting and informative. But this is going to be basically Civics 101. I think you're going to walk away tonight.
Good.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Anita, and I moved here a couple years ago, and I'm just interested for the information.
Excellent. Yes, sir?
Randy Cranston. I'm from beautiful downtown Sublimity. I've been on the Planning Commission for almost 23 years now.
Great. Good for you.
There's always something new to learn. So.
Excellent. Excellent. I think we all know who you are, Mayor, but you
and I. I'm Hank Porter, Staten's mayor, always something new to learn, and somebody else knows more about elected office than me. In fact, everybody knows more about it. But I try to keep up with what's going on.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
I'm Richard Lewis. I'm just mostly here for educational purposes to get an understanding of what is expected of our council members and volunteers as well.
Great. Excellent.
I'm Tiffany Ely. I work at Wild Funeral Service, and we spent most of our 26 years married here in Staten, and I have no idea what the city council did. So I'm learning and possibly run.
Excellent. Excellent.
Yeah.
Awesome. Great. Thank you for being here.
So, Kevin Ely, I'm here, like she said, just kind of here for the information and stuff. Let's see.
Good.
I'm Dan Fleischman. I'm the city's planning and development director. I have worked for local government in two different states over the past 35 years, and state government in a third state. So,
excellent.
I'm just here for the ride.
Perfect.
Carmel Bielenberg, State and Civil League Chamber of Commerce CEO, and I'm just here for information.
Excellent. Good.
I'm Chris Mullen, appointed city council member, not elected, which is a weird role to be in. Worked for the Secretary of State, now I'm working for State Treasury, worked with Kate while she was Secretary, and ethics is just always something that we need to keep up on, so it's good to be here.
Great. Good.
My name's Jordan Orts, and I just moved here to Staten back in November, and I'm just looking forward to getting to know the community better and seeing how I can help improve it.
Excellent.
And I'm Paige Hook, and I'm currently on the Planning Commission, and then I'm also going to be running for City Council, I'm really hoping to just learn whatever you have to dish out my way. So,
all right.
Excited.
Good.
Oh, sorry. I'm not used to this. I'm just here to listen. I brought my crossword. I'm just here to listen.
Excellent.
I'm in my 20s.
I'm Miss Patsy, and I'm a grandmother. And for a long time, I've wanted to make time to get out here and meet people at Staten. For years I've been looking at property east of Salem, and a nice quiet valley for 32 homes would be wonderful, you know. So, and I know I want it between the cities that I've selected.
Great.
Who knows?
Well, I think you both walked away tonight with a really good understanding of your city government, how it operates, what it can do. And I think we've got a couple of candidates back here, right? Or at least one candidate. Is that what I heard when you walked in? You're the campaign manager? Is that what's going on?
I'm the significant other of the campaign manager. been been together for 20 years, so, you know, we just, he decided he wanted to run, and so I'm here to support him and learn what I can, because I've never, ever been really that up on on the government issues and stuff like that. I mean, I try, but I get real confused real easily, so I'm hoping to maybe get something out of it.
Good.
Be as good as smart.
And I'm Wayne Andrews from the city of Almsville. We've lived there for 14 years. I've seen some good points in our town and some bad points in our town. I'm running for council in November, and I'm here to get information and to learn and to be the best councilman I can be.
Excellent. I think we can help make that happen. Good. But you, sir, we're just going around the room talking about introductions, who we are, and why we're here tonight.
Okay. I'm Matthew Williams. I'm new to state. My wife and I bought a house here in January. Here to learn more about our city government.
Great, check it out. All right, good. And then do we just have all staff in the back here? All right. Do you all just want to briefly introduce yourself?
I'm Lance Ludwig. I'm the Director of Public Works.
Great.
I'm Ryan Stevens. I work for the library.
Jan Mosier, Library Director.
I'm Alyssa Angelo, Deputy City Recorder.
Excellent. A little bit more about myself. So Keith gave you a really good introduction to me, a couple of things, some high points or low points. I've worked in and around local, state, federal government for well over 20 years now. I actually began my career working for State Department of Transportation up in Washington State, and then went to work for an organization known as the Association of Washington Cities. Worked for them for about 3 years, and it was that experience that largely inspired me to go to law school. I went to law school, as Keith said, here in Oregon. I'm a native Oregonian, third generation Oregonian. Although most of my family has a Washington presence, if any of you are from the Seattle area or spent much time up there, O'Day High School, that was actually my great-grandfather's brother, who was a bishop in the Catholic family. So long, deep roots here in the Northwest, and it really is a pleasure to be working and being able to do this type of work and be here in Oregon, my home state. And it was great that I got to come back to Oregon for law school. I actually did very well in law school. I surprised myself. I surprised my family members. I graduated third in my class and was rewarded having done so well with a job here in Salem. My first job out of law school was clerking for the Chief Justice of the Oregon Supreme Court, a gentleman by the name of Wally P. Carson, Wally P. Carson Jr., who had a longer family history here in Oregon than I did. If any of you have been around the Salem area for some time, the Carson family is probably a name that you recognize. And I actually have something in common with the mayor of Detroit. He was also on then Senator Carson's staff, so both he and I are employees of Wally Carson. After that, I then moved to the governor's office, where I advised the legal governor, the Oregon's governor. I was the deputy legal counsel there, where I advised mostly on ethics issues, although I handled a couple other issues related to tribal governments and extraditions, as well as clemency requests. But ethics was my mainstay and was really kind of my first introduction to this topic here in Oregon. From there, I moved over to, did a brief stint in private practice, but realized that government really was my calling. Came back to Salem, was an assistant city attorney there, moved myself up to deputy city attorney, and then from there became the deputy city manager. And all told, I was with Salem for about a decade before going to work for the League of Oregon Cities, where I was its general counsel and traveled the state teaching on all types of topics related to local government, including the two topics we'll be covering tonight, which is governance as well as ethics. About a year ago, an opportunity came up to join the Council of Governments as its executive director. As you can see, my career has kind of bounced from law position to management position, and always the deputy, always the bridesmaid, never the bride, until I got this opportunity here to jump from a deputy status to a lead status and being the executive director of the Council of Governments. And it truly is a pleasure to work for this organization. You might be wondering, what is a Council of Governments? What is it that we do? And the reality is that no matter where you go in America, the answer is going to be a little bit different, state to state, and even Council of Government to Council of Government. For us, what we particularly focus on are these four main areas. We are a transportation planning organization. which means we receive state and federal funding, and we use that to invest in key transportation infrastructure, regional transportation infrastructure here within our footprint, which is made up of Polk County, Marion County, and Yamhill County. And we're proud to say that we're a voluntary organization. Cities and counties and other special districts get to choose whether to be a part of us or not, and we have 100% participation by all local governments in our organization. We are also a federally approved small business lending organization. So any of you that have small businesses in the area, if you're looking to expand or grow or have a capital construction project, I've got one of my business cards. We can get you in touch with one of our loan officers. But we are also a federally designated economic development district. We're the staff to that district. We receive federal dollars where we create a 5-year comprehensive economic development plan and then work on projects to help bring business, to bring jobs to our region. In addition, under our economic development program, we also provide on a contract basis land use planning services for our smaller jurisdictions that just simply aren't large enough to warrant a full-time land use planner. And then we offer, as a member service organization, which all COGs are, a whole host of different member services to include trainings like this one tonight. We do recruitments to help with the recruitment and selection of city managers. We also assist with the evaluation of city managers. And we will do charter reviews, which I think our organization did that for Staten not too long ago. We'll come in and assist your citizen group or council, whichever way you choose to go, in updating, refreshing your city charter, which we're going to end up talking a lot about city charters tonight when we talk about the governance issues here in a moment. And if you look at all those member services, there's a common theme. There are two common themes that run throughout. One is we work to help create best practices in cities and in counties because healthy, strong governments make for healthy, strong regions, and that helps benefit all of us. The other thing that we do is we come in and we do the heavy lifting and the difficult work that might be more difficult either for a council to take on its own or for a staff member to do. So for example, recruitment of a city manager, let's say your city manager decides to resign, which they tend to do from time to time, and now you're going to find yourself in a recruitment. It can be a little awkward to tap on the shoulder of the human resources director and have him or her assist the council with the selection of their next boss. And sometimes councils, maybe they have somebody on council that understands the process and understands all the nuances and legal pitfalls that exist, but most often they don't. And so we exist and we're here and we're available to come in and help a city with that. Same with the evaluation of the city manager. Again, sometimes that can be a little bit of a difficult thing for a subordinate to help facilitate, so we're happy to step in and help with that. We also do council goal setting and facilitation, and like I said, training, like on topics tonight. So that's just a brief little infomercial on the Council of Governments, what we do. I can tell you we just scratched the surface. It gets a lot more complicated, a lot more detailed behind each of these main areas. And if you're interested in what the Council of Governments does, please go to our website. It's mwvcog.org, and you can get more information about the COG, our programs and our services, and what we're doing to help position this region for prosperity. So, we're going to now kind of jump into the content here. We're going to talk about local government authority and its limitations. The focus of the next kind of 5 to 10 minutes is really going to be on the city as an entity. And I'm going to encourage you to think about city governments much like corporate governments. And not like state government, not like county government, and certainly not like federal government. Because cities are organized very differently than our other units of government that we have in the United States. And this is going to make a little bit more sense to you as you go along, but if you kind of get into your mindset, if you think of a corporation, a publicly traded corporation, it has a board of directors, right? Made up of people that have been selected because of their acumen in business and their particular familiarity with the direction that that particular company wants to go, and they've been selected by the shareholders, right? Those people that have invested money in that corporation that have equity and want to see it succeed. And that board of directors selects a chairperson to kind of manage the governance of that group of the board of directors. And in turn, that board of directors hires a chief executive officer. Now, can you see the parallels to city government? The voters are your shareholders. Your city council is the board of directors, and your city manager is the chief executive officer. And it's a very efficient way to run an organization and make decisions. And as you're about to see, unlike state level of government, federal level of government, we don't really worry about the separation of powers, the sort of stuff that we learned when we were kids watching Schoolhouse Rock, or we might have learned in civics class, which I know they don't have in high school anymore, unfortunately. We don't concern ourselves with that, because local governments are the government that's closest to the people, and it's the citizens that get involved, those of you that are here tonight, that really maintain the check and balance on that government power. But otherwise, our cities in Oregon in particular operate and function just like a publicly held corporation. And if you keep that model in mind, a lot of what we're going to talk about tonight should make some sense. Yes, Mayor.
John, Linda, would you like to take a question or two on that?
And whenever, anytime. Yep, I can be freely interrupted at any time. Okay. This is your training. I want to make sure I'm covering the topics that are important and useful to you.
Okay,
thank you. So local government authority. Interestingly enough, when our framers formed our system of government, they did not envision local governments, or at least they didn't concern themselves with local governments. Nowhere in the United States Constitution, which sets out the master framework for our system of government in the United States, are you going to find local governments. You see a lot of emphasis placed on the federal government and the separation of powers into the judicial branch, the executive branch, and then dividing those powers between the federal government and state governments. And our system, our model, which is very important here to understand because it's going to carry over into Oregon in a moment, is that our federal government is intended to be a limited powers government. It only has those powers that are expressly set out or necessarily implied by the words of our Constitution. Everything else is reserved unto the states. And the states, in adopting their state constitutions, are then in taking on that embodiment of all other government power and then allocating it however they see fit. And most states, including Oregon, have kind of modeled themselves off the federal model. They have three branches of government. They have a legislative branch, they have an executive branch, they've got a judicial branch. And in Oregon, we've got a bicameral legislature, which means that there's a House and a Senate, just like at the federal level. Interestingly enough, that's not always the case across the United States. Mm-hmm. If anybody's toured the country or worked in other states, we have some states that have a single unicameral legislature. Nebraska is one of them. There's no House and Senate divided. But in Oregon, we've taken painstakingly detail to divide out all of these different sorts of governments. And so as local governments, divide out the government power among all these different branches and agencies. As local governments in Oregon, we then derive our powers from the state. And there's two ways in which states give their local governments power. One is through legislative delegation. So they tell the legislature, their state constitution tells the legislature, you have the authority to create a system by which cities can incorporate and imbue upon them or give them the powers that they're going to have to be able to govern and do all the things that cities do. We call that, actually, a Dillon's Rule state. And it's markedly different than what we have here in Oregon. Can anybody tell me what the opposite of a Dillon's Rule state is and what Oregon is as a state when it comes to local government authority?
Home rule.
Exactly. Home rule. How many of you have heard of home rule before? Just a few hands. So this is a really important concept for everybody to understand. If you want to work with local government, you want to serve in local government, understanding home rule, what it is and what it is not, is incredibly important. Because it's something that's very unique to Oregon, and it really forms the foundation of everything else we're going to talk about tonight. So let me tell you what home rule is not. Remember what I was telling you, that in most states, the way that they create cities and give them government authority to act is through legislative action. The legislature sets forth a statute that says here's the process by which you're going to incorporate. The legislature may choose to approve a charter that gets created. And every city has to look exactly the same as every other city, and they all have to meet that statutory template. And in those Dillon's Rule states, a local government only has that amount of authority that is expressly given to them by state law. What does that sound like? Remember in our U.S. Constitution where we had the federal government and state government, the federal government was a limited powers government. Only those things that are expressly stated in the U.S. Constitution, unless necessarily implied. That's what how those states operate. That's how those cities in those states operate. They are limited powers entities. In Oregon, we completely turned that around. Back in 1906, through what was known then as a progressive movement led by Hugh Wren, this was the same time that we put the initiative and referendum in our state constitution. We allowed the voters of every community to adopt their own home rule charter, setting up a system of government for its local government, however it saw fit. And so in a Dillon's Rule state, when a city wants to take action, the way that we describe it is you have to show somebody where in state law it says you can do it. But in Oregon, we flip that around. We're a home rule state, which means that our home rule cities, and by the way, all 241 cities in the state of Oregon have since adopted home rule charters since 1906, including Staten. In a home rule state, it's a show me where it says I can't. As a city government, you get to do whatever you want, unless there's another law that says you can't. A state law that limits your authority, or a federal or state constitutional principle that limits your authority. So you can't declare war on Canada. Sorry about that. There's a federal constitutional prohibition on that. But if you wanted to license dogs, you can do so, as long as there's not a state law that says that we're going to set that over and tell counties they get to do that. If you wanted to run a hot dog stand, you could do that. If you wanted to have a pool, you could do that. If you want a park system, you could do that. Your own police force, your own fire force. You want to do your own space exploration, subject to any sort of federal limitations of NASA trying to control that area of the market. In Oregon, you get to do that. In 1906, Hugh Wren and those that adopted this constitutional provision, their vision was essentially to create city-states, to infuse upon local governments that amount of authority that otherwise was held by the state legislature. It's pretty powerful stuff, if you think about it. It's a pretty powerful model. Now, since 1906, we've had a lot of judicial interpretations of this constitutional provision and its limited city, boxed in city authority to quite some degree today. But still, its basic tenets hold true, and that is as a home rule city, Dayton, Almsville, Turner, trying to think of where else I heard before we went around the room. All of these cities, when you're elected to office and you're a member of that council, you basically have carte blanche to legislate on any area that you want. You want to ban plastic bags? You can do so. Again, so long as there's not some other law that tells you you can't. So it's kind of like, you know, that old adage, when it comes to marriage, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than it is for permission. A home rule state's kind of built upon that on that predicate, that you get to go forward and do what you want to do until somebody tells you no, you don't get to do that. That somebody most notably being the state. A little bit, you know, some kind of adages here. Home rule authority allows local voices to make local choices. We here in Oregon really value and we recognize that government power really comes from the consent of the governed, the voters themselves. And then again, in adopting that home rule charter, the voters are delegating up to its city government those authorities that is expressly set out in the charter to be able to do those things make life good, to regulate the health, welfare, and safety of that particular area. And so long as you're not conflicting, those enactments don't conflict with the Oregon Constitution, Oregon criminal law, the state's got a lock on that. We can't create our own crimes in Oregon at the local government level. And as long as it doesn't conflict with a preemptive statute. And there's a lot of preemption going on. In fact, your state league, the organization I used to work for, League of Oregon Cities, was founded principally to be able to fight off preemptive legislation from the legislature. And the legislature is constantly trying to tell you how to do your business. So there's no legislators in the room today, which is really unfortunate. Normally they do, every now and then we'll end up at one of these. And they are often very shocked to hear and to learn that in Oregon, we've elevated local governments, city governments in particular, that have adopted home rule charters on an equal footing with them. Because we're all taught in civics class that, you know, that you've got this higher level of government, federal government, which gets to tell the state what to do, and the state in turn gets to tell the local governments what to do. but that's not entirely true here in Oregon. Unless they've preempted us, which again, when it comes to criminal laws, they do have a lock on that. We cannot allow that what state law prohibits, nor can we prohibit what state law allows. Marijuana is a really good example of this. The voters, through initiative, have decriminalized marijuana here in the state of Oregon. And at the local government level, with a lot of cities, when I was working for the league, all of a sudden started asking, hey, can we recriminalize it within our borders? No, you can't. You can't make it a crime to possess marijuana within the limitations set out in state law. But what you can do, subject to any other state preemption, is you can begin to regulate its location and its placement. And then we started to do that, and the legislature got a little testy about that, and they tried to preempt us through the enactment of certain civil laws that says you cities can't do certain things. And that went to litigation, and we successfully defended, when I was at the league, we successfully defended cities' ability to maintain that local control over marijuana businesses and where they can locate, and some other reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions around those operations. The preemption in Oregon, and I'm not going to get too far into the weeds on this, if you are a budding lawyer and really want to get into this, want to talk to me about it, I'm happy to chew your ear off ad nauseum. But understand that in order to preempt local governments, the state legislature has to be explicit. They have to say, yes, it is our intent to preempt local government authority, which is a really hard thing for them to do. It's a really hard thing for them to say, particularly when there are good local government watchdogs, like the League of Oregon Cities, or even folks like this who now learn how home rule works, that are now watching their state legislatures and saying, no, you know what? Stay out of our backyard. Let us do business the way we want to do business, because we have a constitutional right to be able to do so. It becomes very much more politically difficult for the legislature to adopt preemptive statutes. And one thing that they definitely cannot touch is the form of governance. That local government charter that is adopted by the voters, that allocates government powers among the various entities within City Hall, that is a place where the legislature cannot step in. Even if they attempted to set out a statute that says all cities have to look alike and here's our cookie cutter approach and we're preempting you from adopting any charter that looks differently, the courts have made it very clear that you cannot do that. So the voters in Staten, the voters in Almsville, the voters in Sublimity, all get the ability to decide how they're going to allocate their government authority. And that's what we're going to talk about next, is how do we allocate the government authority. Now that you understand that Oregon's a home rule state, which means that we've vested all government power in our local governments. They can do whatever they want, including run a hot dog stand, unless some, you know, annoying state legislature told us we can't do that at the local government level. Then how is it that we have allocated these authorities? And what are these government powers, by the way, that I've been talking about? And using generically this notion of government power, what is that exactly? Well, again, going back to our basic civics class, we learned a long time ago that we divide our government powers into three different branches: legislative, executive, and judicial. And at the federal level, we maintain that separation. At the state level, we maintain that separation. But the remarkable thing is that when it comes to local governments here in Oregon, every single home rule charter has pretty much done the same thing. And that is they vest all powers in the city council. Meaning that the city or city council, if you're a member of a council, you are a legislator, you're a president, and you're a judge. And at any given time, in any council meeting, you could be wearing any one of those three hats. Now, why would we do that? If our framers painstakingly divided government authority among three separate but equal branches, so as to one couldn't become more powerful than the other, why would we just throw that out the window when it comes to local governments and say, we're going to vest all three of these government powers, the power to make laws, the power to execute laws, and the power to adjudicate the law. Why would we put that all in the same group of elected people? Those of you that currently serve on a council, something heated happens at the council meeting the night before. You're now at the grocery store, you're standing in line. Have you ever had anybody tap on your shoulder and talk to you about what happened the night before?
Oh, heavens no.
Have you ever got a call about 10 o'clock at night from an angry resident of your city who's upset because...
12, 1, heavens no.
Yeah, right? The reason why we throw this whole notion of separation of powers out the window is because local government is the government that's closest to the people. And the people are the check on the abuse of government authority, which is why we're very comfortable at the local government level saying, and particularly here in Oregon, because of our home rule ethic, but saying, nope, we're going to vest all three of these powers in our city council. So when you understand that concept, you now understand home rule, you can see that one of the most powerful units of government in the state of Oregon is your city council. It is an incredible implement of government authority. It's like nowhere else in the country do we have anything like this. I'm going to tell you, Oregon is unique when it comes to the amount of home rule authority we give our city councils. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about each one of these rules, what it looks like, and what some of the limitations are as a city council exercises its legislative authority, its executive authority, and its what's really we call quasi-judicial authority. And those of you that serve on planning commissions, you're experts in quasi-judicial land, and feel free to speak up when we get to that part. Our legislative role, I think most people understand this intuitively. We know that other than the voters, which have retained upon themselves the powers of initiative and referendum, the council is the only body within the city that can enact legislation. And legislation sets out the left and right hand limits of what we can as residents of that community do. It sets out various ways in which certain government decisions will be made and decided. They're laws, we call them ordinances, but they are laws and they have the full force and effect of the law, and we are all bound to follow them. And if we don't, then there are certain consequences that fall upon us if we don't follow those laws. And your city charters provide that, like at the federal level and the state level in adopting laws, there's a certain process that we have to go through. Each city charter is a little bit different, although most of them say you have to have 2 readings of an ordinance, you have to have an opportunity for the public to come in and comment on that, because ultimately, once it's passed by the city council, that now becomes the law of the land, and everybody in that city has to follow that. Oh, by the way, I said at the very beginning, other than the voters, which have retained upon themselves the powers of initiative and referendum, can anybody tell me what the difference is between those two? Initiative, referendum? I'm going to add a third one on there, referral, because I think people often get confused about what these three different things are. Anybody want to tell me what an initiative is, Mayor?
Comes an idea that comes up from the people in the form of a petition to enact a new ordinance or law.
Exactly.
That's my understanding of it.
Yep, that's exactly right. An initiative, if you couldn't hear the mayor, is one in which the voters have taken upon themselves to turn an idea into a law. And if they gather enough signatures, then it goes on the ballot and the voters can enact that into law. That's how Oregon became a legal state with regard to marijuana. Referendum. Who can tell me what a referendum is? Go ahead, Mayor.
Something that comes down from the council, put to a vote of the people to settle an issue, hopefully.
Right. Referendum and referral look somewhat similar, but they are markedly different. A referendum, in both cases, we're talking about a council action. So we're no longer, the idea isn't being generated by the people. There's been some sort of council action. And in a referendum, what's happening is the people are upset about that. And they say, we don't like the law you just passed. So what we're going to do is we're going to go out and get enough signatures and put that issue on the ballot. And we're going to have the whole community decide. And practically speaking, realistically speaking, that only happens when somebody's upset with what the council has done. And they think that if it was put to a vote of the people, then what's going to happen is the measure is going to go down at the polls. It's rare, I'm not aware of any circumstance, where somebody's ordered a referendum, that's the terminology we use when the voters collect enough signatures, have ordered a referendum on a piece of legislation that they actually support. The gas tax was a good example of that. Legislature passes a gas tax. There was a big movement to gather a bunch of signatures and put that to a vote of the people, and ultimately that did pass. So that referendum was not successful, is the terminology we use. And then the third thing, again for you budding counselors or current counselors, a referral is where the council says, we're going to take a pass on whether to adopt this as a law. Maybe we don't have a majority or a clear majority here, or we're not really certain the way that the public would feel about this. And so what we're going to do is we're going to punt it to a vote of the people. We're going to refer it out for a vote, and rather than us acting on it first. And one of the key things here, if you're a government nerd like myself, to understand is that when we adopt ordinances, just like when we adopt laws at the state level, we have the option as governing bodies to put on that ordinance or that piece of legislation what's called an emergency clause. Can anybody tell me what an emergency clause is and what it does?
Aside from being heavily abused, and maybe sort of a legislation passed during the last session had emergency clauses attached to it.
It did.
It said it's something that needs to be enacted immediately and can't be referred to a vote of the people or can't be sent down. It's going to go to law.
Right. You can't order a referendum on it. That's exactly right. So an emergency clause is one that says, the governing body says, in our view, in our ultimate wisdom, we believe that this enactment needs to go into effect immediately, right now, right away. And because of that immediate effective date, what it does constitutionally is it forecloses the people's right of ordering a referendum. And as the councilor said, about 90% of the legislation coming out of the state legislature today has an emergency clause attached to it, because they want to stop the ability of sending it to the vote of the people. So understand that, particularly if you're involved in your community, if you're sitting on a city council, if you're thinking about joining a city council, understand that it's a really important legal significance of adopting ordinances with an emergency clause, because it means you're foreclosing the right of the people to collect signatures and put it on the ballot. Administrative role. This is the executive role. With Staten, Almsville, Sublimity as well, all of these cities have formed themselves as council manager forms of government. That's not always the case in Oregon. Sometimes we have what's called a mayor-council form of government, where the councilors often will divide amongst themselves the various administrative duties that in a council manager form of government we've put in the city manager. And the city manager, again, if you've gone back to that corporate model that I started with, if you think about it in those terms, the city manager is there to implement and execute the policy decisions by the governing body, by the city council, so that legislation and any policies that they adopt is all guidance for the city manager, and the city manager then is a professional manager, hires staff, and executes that policy.
Essentially a COO role.
What's that? Essentially a COO or CEO role, exactly. And what's key, and this is true in corporate America as well, is that these charters that have council manager forms of government, they also have what we call a non-interference clause. The non-interference clause says to the city council, you cannot individually direct the city manager in the performance of his or her duties. Mm-hmm. You can't tell them who to hire, who to fire, which laws to enforce, which ones not to enforce. And in fact, if you do so, there may be grounds for removal by a vote of the council. The state has that in its charter. Not all do. All of them that are council manager forms of government have a non-interference clause. I'm not aware of any in Oregon that don't. But some of them have removal consequences. Others don't. Staten is one that does. So if you're running for office here in Staten, or you're a current member of the council, and you take it upon yourself to direct the city manager how to do his performance, understand you're putting your own job in jeopardy. Instead, what you need to do, if you're displeased with something that is happening, you have to bring that to a council level. And you have to then, as a council, decide, and we're going to talk a little bit more about this at the very end, you have to decide as a council whether to direct the city manager to do something or not do something. Because ultimately, the power rests in the city council. It doesn't rest in any singular city councilor.
With the exception of city council meetings where everything's on the agenda. In our charter.
What do you mean by that?
For instance, we can discuss, I wouldn't dream to tell Keith to do anything in terms of a personal decision.
Right.
That's none of my business, that's why we hire Keith.
Right.
But at a city council meeting,
once you've got a council meeting, that's what I'm saying.
Everything can be discussed.
If you can get your fellow councilors, so.
Right. Keith does a fine job of running the administrative run. Why the heck would we care?
Right.
But if there was an issue at a council meeting, that is the venue for those of you.
That's right. The council meeting is the venue to discuss it. But the key there is that you want to discuss the policy implications, not the administrative parts.
Sure.
Allowing the city manager, because often in a city council meeting, there, which, you know, this class, taught these classes in a day-long seminar where we talk about roles, responsibilities, and liabilities. And I can tell you that if you start to get into the operational piece in a city council meeting, you're now entering into an area of where there's potential legal liability that you really don't want to go.
We're at the 30,000 foot level.
Sure. Absolutely. Absolutely. Again, the administrative role varies depending upon the size of the city or county and whether you have a paid professional manager, which again, in all of our local governments here in the valley, within our region, we do have that. And I'm going to jump now to the quasi-judicial role, because I think this is something that's a little bit of a surprise to people. Unless they've come to city council or been involved in city government through the planning commission route, most people don't realize that one of the roles or hats that elected officials wear is that of a judge. And there are special rules that apply when you're making a quasi-judicial decision. So it's important to understand what is a quasi-judicial decision and how does it differentiate from a legislative decision or an administrative decision. And it's this. Normally, quasi-judicial decisions, we see these in land use cases. Other cases might include licensing decisions or appeals of a licensing decision. And they're always going to involve three sort of characteristics, the decision that's in front of the council. First of all, you must make a decision. You have to vote on the matter. You can't table it and set it aside, because state law or local law requires the council or the planning commission to make a decision, which means that this is often accompanied by some sort of application by a particular person or a group of people, or it's an appeal to the council on a particular application. And in making that decision, the council is always going to take a look at the facts, and they're going to take a look at the law or the decision criteria, which is just a non-lawyer way of saying the law, in making that decision. So just like a judge, you know, did you run the red light? Did you not run the red light? Were you speeding? Were you not speeding? There's a statute that says you won't run red lights and you won't go over 55 on the state highway. And now they're going to look at the officer and the evidence and make a decision. Did you violate that law or not? City councils do exactly the same thing when it comes to certain land use decisions or when it comes to certain licensing decisions. And the decision is going to affect one person or just a few people, as opposed to the general public. Now, let's take a piece of legislation and kind of run this through it, kind of show you what's not a quasi-judicial decision. Let's decide that we're going to, as a council, take up the issue of whether or not to ban plastic bags. Well, do we have to make a decision? Do we have to adopt a law whether or not to adopt that ban? No. We could choose not to do that. It doesn't require any facts or criteria. This is just purely political judgment on my part as to whether I think this is good governance or not for my community. And the decision is going to affect everybody. It's not going to affect just a few. So that's a legislative decision. Clearly, without any doubt, that's a legislative decision. And again, the reason why you want to differentiate is because when it comes to legislative decisions, you can interact with the public, and the public can interact with you. We call that lobbying. We call that advocacy. But when it comes to quasi-judicial decisions, if the public interacts with you about that, that's a no-no. Just like your judge that's sitting there going to decide your speeding ticket, you wouldn't want somebody whispering in their ear without you being present as to your conduct. You know, you don't want your child writing them a letter and saying, well, mom speeds on the freeway all the time, right, without you knowing about that. We don't allow that. Instead, when you be able to preserve the integrity of these decisions because the law is being applied and people are going to be bound by it, what we do is we say, no, there's no such thing as what's called an ex parte content, which means that all of the evidence has to occur within the context of the hearing. And that in the hearing, where the applicant or the affected people have an opportunity to be present and have an opportunity to be heard. And they can hear what's being said to the decision maker and be given an opportunity to rebut. Yes, sir?
Quick question regarding ex parte context. I'm somewhat famous for being the goat for declaring lots of things. But once I receive the email, let's say an email for Pacific Towers case or for Sunset Coffee's case, once I receive that email, whether I open that email or open that letter or look at that postcard or not, I have been in contact.
I think so.
Which is why I always declare that sort of thing. A lot of, well, some of the people in the dais think that if they don't read it, they didn't inhale.
So if you don't read it, if you received it but you didn't read it, is it technically an ex parte contact? No. But in a later, because ex parte contacts that are not disclosed can give reason for a subsequent appeal, it could be maybe hard, it could be hard to show that you didn't read it. Because emails can be opened and unopened, and then you've got to figure out the whole electronic trail. So when I was a city attorney, I would regularly advise my elected officials, if you receive any emails whatsoever on this, just get it into the record. You know, send it, forward it to the city recorder, and make sure that it ends up in the packet and on the record. Now, do you have to, at the beginning of the hearing, say, I received the following emails from these people? No, you don't need to do that. So long as the staff person, if you forward it to the staff people, and they in turn put it in the packet, and the applicants had an opportunity to see, you know, all the correspondence that the council's received on a particular matter, that's sufficient, because now it's no longer ex parte. Ex parte is Latin meaning from or by one party, meaning that only one party, without the other party being present, had a contact with the decision maker. And that's a bad thing, because that other party now is disadvantaged, because they don't know what was said. And the cure for it, if it happens, because it does happen, it happens quite regularly, is for the decision maker to fully disclose or otherwise make the content of that communication known to the other parties, so that in the hearing, they've got an opportunity to rebut. And if you fail to do so, that can be significant grounds for an appeal, and it puts that council's decision in jeopardy. Mm-hmm. And again, voters don't understand this, because they say, hey, look, we voted you to make decisions. We voted you into office to adopt laws, and you're my counselor, you're my mayor, I get to talk to you about this, right? Unfortunately, no. Not with certain types of decisions. And it's a consequence of vesting all government power, judicial, executive, legislative, into one body. This is the one downside to it in Oregon. The good side is that we can be efficient, we can do what we want, but the downside is it creates a little bit of a legal trap for the uneducated when it comes to quasi-judicial decisions and ex parte contacts. Everybody tracked in? Anybody confused about this as to what I'm referring to and how it all works and why the rule exists? I can tell you, when I was with the city of Salem, a former Chamber of Commerce director, I mean, I thought he was going to gouge my eyes out. He was so infuriated by this concept. He goes, well, of course I get to talk to my city councilors about this land use application. And I said, no, Mike, you don't. You don't get to do that. At least if you do, I mean, yeah, you do get to do that, but understand you're putting your councilors in a bad spot, and they're going to have to go through and disclose everything that's being said. You don't get to lobby them in secret, because it's not fair to the applicant. It's not fair to the other side. Just like in a court of law, if you were ever involved in a civil case or even a criminal case, you wouldn't want somebody whispering into the judge's ear without knowing what was being said.
So when we receive a communication, we need to share a communication with the court.
That's it.
The administrator and the council.
And you should decide within your governing body as to how you're going to handle this. You know, and a lot of councils have council rules. It's certainly not a new issue that I'm talking about today, maybe new to some of you, but this is a well-worn path that many cities have walked down, and they've got their own mechanism for dealing with it. Yeah. Saw a hand. Go ahead.
So I had a question about sharing it. Since you don't have to say your ex parte contact before, like, or at the meeting, if you are like a procrastinator and it's 5 o'clock, your city recorder's already gone, can you print that out as copies to hand out to people then?
Yes.
Yes. So that you don't have to explain the whole thing during the meeting of what was said. You can say, here's a copy of what was said.
Yes, as long as your fellow decision makers and the applicant and anybody testifying in that hearing has a copy. So that might end up being a lot of copies. It might be easier just to read it at the beginning of the hearing. And it's important to note that you have to do that at the opening of the hearing. So if it wasn't otherwise included in the packet, you need to get all those ex parte contacts out on the table at the very outset. Again, why? It's to give anybody who's participating in that hearing, the applicant, maybe a neighborhood group that's opposed to it, an opportunity to hear what you've been told, and if they don't think it's right, to speak to it.
So we give those to the city recorder and the city attorney to the president.
Yep. And your city attorney's a good, you know, shepherd or a Sherpa to kind of navigate the Himalayas of ex parte contacts. Now, a couple of couple of quick war stories or tips from the field. As I like to say, based on my own experience, editorial. Sunday editorial. Sunday paper comes out, there's an editorial about a large, let's say it's a Walmart, hypothetically a Walmart development, that council's going to be hearing on Monday night council meeting, and at least 50% of the council read that editorial. What do you think? Ex parte contact or not?
It's problematic.
Yep, on the newspaper, on the general community, I agree. That's the argument.
It's on the internet, it's public record.
Right.
Not the public record, but it's not part of the record of the proceedings unless someone enters it into the record.
Which is why you would share it with the attorney in the city to record.
That's right, your community development director, and there's an actual case in Luba that said, yes, editorials are ex parte contacts. So if you're city councilor and you get received not just from residents, it's generally what we're looking for, right? We're looking for that tap on the shoulder in the grocery store, or we're looking for that email that got sent to us at midnight. Ex parte contacts can come from other sources, including your newspaper.
So you share that.
You share it, and you're good.
You're good.
Yep, you're absolutely good. That's exactly right. Staff, not ex parte contacts. So if you're talking with your staff, staff can share information with you one-on-one without the applicant there or any other parties there. That's okay. That's not an ex parte contact. Yes, sir.
Speaking as a planning commission member, one of the things that I really dislike from the applicants tonight, don't tolerate it from the other planning commission members, somebody walking in at 7 o'clock and giving me a book and saying, here, I want this entered into the record. So
right.
You can continue the hearing, you can call for a recess, especially if it involves something that may involve staff time. We require our staff reports a week ahead of time.
Yep.
So because they're 8 to 5 with breaks and other work responsibilities Monday through Friday. If I get it on Friday night, it means on Monday and I work 8 to 5 Monday, I don't have time for questions and answers. And I don't tolerate it from applicants really well, and I really don't like it from the other planning commission members.
Sure.
So.
And for good reason.
Procrastinating is not in anybody's best interest.
It's really not.
Especially if what you've got to say is important, because you can't go through it with 30 people sitting out in the audience. We're going to read for a while.
Right. Yeah. Right. Exactly. I wholeheartedly agree with you. Other questions? I see another hand go up. All right. Last thing I want to talk about is quasi-judicial. Kind of goes hand in glove with ex parte contact, but it can be a lot larger than ex parte contact. That's this concept of bias. When you're acting as a judge, just like we expect of our judicial officers that we've elected to the courts, we want our decision makers to be free from any bias. We want them to have an open mind and to be able to look at the facts and look at the law and make the call that they think is fair and just without any sort of personal influence. And bias can take a couple of different forms. A bias can take the form of you are just, so strong in your religious beliefs, so strong in your political beliefs, so strong in your social beliefs, that you just can't see the world any other way. And that influences you to the point where you can't objectively apply the law to the facts to make a decision. Another place that bias comes into play, and we're going to talk about this during the second part of tonight, and that is conflicts of interest. You have a personal stake in the decision so that you now are biased because you're going to either benefit or maybe it's going to work to your detriment, but either case, either outcome could result from the decision, then bias is going to exist. And that, if you go forward with the decision, not only can you get yourself in trouble with the Ethics Commission, which again, the second part of tonight, we're going to talk about ethics laws and the commission that I've recently been appointed to, but it also subjects that decision to an appeal and grounds for reversal if you participated in it and you had bias.
Quick question. Should the officers screen this, serving myself and Councilor Leibold, live in a geographic area of revitalized downtown Staten or Friends of Old Town Staten? My house, unencumbered, tends to be zone commercial light industrial. I'm sure that Ms. Leibold's house is public commercial as well. We exist in this chunk of 5 blocks or 7 blocks, and I declare that at every meeting. If urban development takes off, whatever, we will benefit from the increase in values of our house, but it's so ethereal and so long term. I still declare it, and it doesn't bias me at all, but how does one handle something like that? I mean, I can't really see myself as
being biased and saying I'm going to vote this way or that way about the same.
So we're going to have, when we get to the ethics part tonight, we'll talk about the difference between actual conflicts and potential conflicts, and what Oregon law requires you to do. What you just described is kind of a classic potential conflict. It may or may not, I'm not certain, it just kind of depends. There's a lot of factors beyond just the decision tonight. But if it goes a particular way, it could be to my benefit or to my detriment. That's a potential conflict. Ethics laws require you to disclose it on the record so that the public's aware of that. Whether that constitutes bias is whether you, within your own mind, can say, in spite of that, I can still remain, I can even vote against my own best interest here tonight. But understand that when you make that disclosure, one of the reasons why Oregon law requires you to make that disclosure is because now all applicants' eyes are on you. All, you know, the community's eyes are on you. And they're really saying, well, is he really being impartial with this or not? And so the disclosure is required so that they can then hold you accountable, and then you make the choice you think is right. You know, are you biased? Are you not biased? If not, then there's nothing that says you can't participate in the decision. But if somebody, you know, Monday morning quarterbacking you says, well, I'm not so sure because, you know, I heard him say this or somebody heard him say that, then it could become grounds for a potential appeal in the future. So you're in a gray area here, which is partly why these jobs get so difficult. Why, again, I had one person get one of these trainings say, you know what, that's it, we're resigning. But really, it's not as difficult as it sounds. But
and then the subpoint B is one of the many hats I wear is building leads platinum affordable housing complexes. There's a 1% chance we may build one on the second in Florence, but I actually recuse myself from all the abatement, you know, all the urban tax discussions and all the data, because that is something that may happen.
As Keith said in my introduction, you know, I'm an officer in the United States Army and Reserve, and discretion truly is the better part of valor. In advising local government officials, and by advising, I don't mean just in a legal capacity, but just in a consularity capacity, I tell them all the time, if you don't have to make a decision, and if all eyes are on you, and it's and it just doesn't feel right, step off. Step off the dais. Let the rest of the council make the decision. I once had a city councilor ask me when I was with the city of Salem, hey, can you just boil ethics down to a bumper sticker? And I said, sure, I can do that. Don't take anything from anybody, and if it doesn't feel right, don't do it. And as long as you follow those two rules, you're 99% of the time you're going to be fine with ethics. But yeah, recusal is always... the cure for bias is recusal. Even if objectively you think you can remain open-minded, if you feel like, you know, the view of your counselors is different and the view of the applicant is different, then, you know, to protect the integrity of the decision, go ahead and step down. Nothing says you have to participate in that decision. All right, and when it comes to council decisions, this is kind of the, I end on this note because it's probably, as I said at the beginning, if you remember nothing else from my talk tonight, know that you have resources to navigate these various things. But the other key takeaway is this. When it comes to government power, which we've vested a lot in our local governments, as you can see by now, when it comes to local government power, it is vested in the council as a whole. Individual councilors, individual staff members lack authority unless one of two things have happened. Either your charter sets out those duties, like in your case, the city manager has certain duties spelled out in the charter. The mayor has certain duties spelled out in the charter. The mayor has the authority in stating to appoint people to boards and commissions, to call meetings of the council. I think set the agenda, going off memory, so don't quote me on that one. City manager has a whole host of duties that are set out there. Your council president has duties as well. But unless it's set out in the charter or otherwise delegated by a vote of the council, which is really kind of C point number one, that all power is vested in the council, if the council chooses to delegate a certain activity or power to one of its own, then it can do so. But if those two things don't exist, you as an individual councilor, I'm sorry to break it to you, have absolutely zero, squat, nilch legal authority. You're one voice, you're one vote as part of an overall group. And unless that group has voted, you can't bind the city, you can't direct the city, you can't promise anything to anybody related to the city. And if you do so, you actually subject yourself to personal liability, which is that other component of the class that we didn't add tonight, that again, kind of adds a whole other hour to our talk tonight. But understand the consequences are great. So what does that mean as a counselor? And it can be kind of frightening to think about this. One is, you know, don't promise more than you can deliver. make sure you run everything through your fellow counselors. Understand, if you're new to office, understand the systems and the mechanisms that are in place to put issues on your city council agenda. And follow that process, and respect the process. And respect that just as you don't have any individual authority, neither does your fellow counselors. And you've got to be able to work together to get along. Reasonable minds can disagree. We can all be of different walks of life, different political parties. We can all be of different professions. And that's the beautiful thing about local government, is that at the council level, we often have a really good cross-reference of our community. And the system forces you to all get together and collectively make a decision, because unless you've collectively made a decision, no decision has been made. Unless it was set out otherwise in a chart. Any questions about that concept? So whereas in a home rule state, it's a show me where it says I can't situation when it comes to city government as a whole, you as a local government elected official, it's a reverse of that. It's a show me where it says I can. Unless the charter says you can, or unless your fellow counselors have voted to say that you can, the answer is you can't. You can't sign a contract, you can't promise a deal, you can't sell a piece of property, and frankly, you're foolish to try to get involved in those sorts of matters. You're going to subject yourself to a whole lot of political pain, as well as potential legal liability. And I hate to put it so bluntly, but I see it happen time and time again. And one of my jobs as the executive director of a regional government that's working to make strong, healthy local governments is to speak truth to power. So thank you for listening to that piece. That really ends that piece of tonight's presentation. The next thing we're going to talk about is ethics. I see that we're at about an hour mark here, so the rest of my presentation I can go through probably in about 20 to 30 minutes for those who are interested. Would you guys like me to go ahead and push on, or would you like to take a 5-minute break?
Push on. Back to recusal. Is it better to let a counselor recuse himself from a decision when they haven't declared a conflict that you know one exists?
No. We're going to talk about that next. So that's a great question. We're going to talk about that when it comes to conflicts of interest.
Okay.
All right. Good. So hold on to that. If I fail to do that, which I won't, but if I don't hit that, you're going to have
to. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else? All right. So the next block of instructions on government ethics. And when it comes to ethics, there is a whole host of statutes in Oregon that govern our conduct. Actually, these are a lot of criminal statutes. They govern everybody's conduct, but local government officials included. And we have a special chapter, Chapter 244, that used to be known as Government Standards and Practices, which frankly was a little bit better terminology in my view of what this body of law really does. It sets out what we think are best practices for making government decisions, whether it's the executive branch, judicial branch, legislative branch, they're all subject to these laws. And people colloquially started calling them ethics, and a couple years ago, the Government Standards and Practices Commission got renamed to the Oregon Government Ethics Commission, and this body of law got renamed to ethics. And it is rooted certainly in kind of moral, virtuous type of concepts. But really, if you look at this is how we ensure the integrity of our decisions. This is how we ensure the integrity of the decision-making process so that the public has faith in our local government decisions. Then you're going to be kind of on the right track as to what these bodies of laws really try to get at. There are a whole host of subsets within Chapter 244, and there's lots of really good resources online. The League of Oregon Cities has information on all of this. The Oregon Government Ethics Commission, its staff, will come out and do trainings. There are also online modules that you can take where you can do a deep dive into each one of these different areas. I'm not going to cover all of this. Frankly, to do so, it's about a half day to a full day class to cover everything that there is with regard to ethics. Instead, I'm going to kind of cover just high level and a couple of key areas that get local government officials in trouble the most. And the point of tonight is to really familiarize you with this area of the law, not to make you a subject matter expert. And incidentally, this law applies to anybody who is currently serving in public office, whether it's appointed position, elected a position, paid staff position, or a volunteer position. If you're a volunteer commissioner, a planning commissioner or serve on an advisory committee, this body of law applies to you. And it applies to candidates. So once you've filed your candidacy form, this is a body of law you definitely want to become familiar with. And your first go-to resource is a document known as the Guide to Ethics for Public Officials. It is published by the Oregon Ethics Commission. A simple Google search will turn this document up in just a few clicks. It is not very long. It's about 20 to 30 pages. It is written by non-lawyers for non-lawyers, which means it's very easy to understand. It won't put you to sleep. It will keep your attention. And in my view, it is absolutely mandatory reading for anybody coming into local government or anybody that is running for local office. It should be one of the first things that you consult and read, because this body of law, as you're about to see, can be kind of a trap for the unwary. In local government, we insulate our decisions in ways that from the local business community, we don't. I came from a culture that was a really heavy gift-giving culture. It was just part of what we did, particularly when I was in private practice. I had a private expense account. I would take clients out and wine them and dine them all the time. That's the sort of behavior that is absolutely prohibited when it comes to government officials, even in the smallest amounts. So again, this is a body of law that you definitely want to become familiar with, whether you're working, whether you're in, representing the private sector and working with local government officials, or you're a budding local government official or a current official, definitely pick up this guide and read it. So again, I'm going to cover just kind of a couple of the key rules that seem to get people in trouble. My goal here today is to familiarize you with these rules, not make you subject matter experts. First one is use of public office. And you can see on my slide decks, I've got citations to each of the state statutes. You can go back and look at these. And by the way, Keith has a copy of my slides, so if you want to get a copy from him after tonight, you're free to do so. None of this is copyrighted. It's all public records. And you are free to use and disseminate it for your own use. Public officials may not use or attempt to use their position to obtain a financial benefit. The opportunity for that benefit otherwise would not have been available to them but for holding public office. We often refer to this as the but-for rule or the use of office rule. It's really the bedrock principle behind all of our ethics rules is this one right here. And sometimes people can navigate one or two of the other ethics rules, whether it's a gift rule or a conflict rule, but this rule will generally catch them up every time. One thing I want to note that is unique to Oregon is that our ethics rules are really focused on financial benefits. So when I was with the city of Salem, we had our own ethics laws and we had our own use of public office that stripped out the financial benefit piece. So if you had a counselor that, for example, was a board member of a particular charity, and every time a council meeting came along, they would use that pulpit as a way to advance that charity. That was violating Salem's use of office rule. The state law is really just focused on money. And most of our state rules are just focused on money. So if it's a financial benefit to you that otherwise isn't available to you but for holding public office, it's a violation. There are some exceptions, which we'll talk about in a minute. But can anybody give me some examples of where this rule might be violated?
Well, if I were not to declare, accuse myself from second influence, if I had influence with Dan and got Dan to agree to force Julie and Tom to sell the property because Tom Hawks' cars are insured to use enforcement, then I would build a lease platform thing there and probably make $300,000 personally.
That's clearly going to violate. It's going to violate not only the conflicts, it's going to violate
a whole bunch of ethics rules.
Right.
Yeah, there's a long train to do that, but that's,
yes, go ahead.
How about stating multiple times what business you own during a council meeting, which could then get people to want to use your business from that point on?
I think that could certainly get close to it, absolutely. Yep, I mean, depending upon the frequency, and showing up to a council meeting with your company logo on your shirt, probably okay. But using it to make an infomercial, which I don't know, are your council meetings broadcast to the public?
They're on YouTube.
YouTube, all right, yeah. Using it for some free advertising, yeah, like I could potentially see that, yeah.
Hey, we'll have to advertise Alzheimer's and venture clinics.
Well, we're going to talk about nonprofits too, when it comes to conflicts of interest as well. The recent example came out last year, county commissioner, central part of the state, snows a lot in Central Oregon. You've never been there. And a particular county commissioner thought it'd be a good idea to direct the public works director to plow the street in front of his home first. And then you know, when that really didn't help him get out of his driveway, which was about a mile and a half long, because it's Central Oregon, every driveway is a mile and a half long in Central Oregon, he decided to get behind the snowplow himself and plow the rest of his driveway. Clear violation of this rule, right? He was using his office for his own personal gain. The directing of the staff person is clearly, you know, inappropriate and a violation, but also, you know, using public equipment for his personal use. That's probably the number one thing that catches people up, is using government equipment for personal use time and time again. Where I've seen violations of this rule, that's generally what it is. Now, sometimes people say, well, what if the county had a tool share program and anybody could have used the snow plow? Well, then it doesn't satisfy the but-for test, because it's not just because of their position, but now it's available to everybody. But I'll submit to you that the insurance company is not going to let the county if there's no plow generally available to the public. Right, but other certain things, you know, use of a library, city councilor walks in, you know, as long as they're not getting preferential treatment in the use of the library, of course they get to use all the public amenities that are available to the rest of us. There are some really key exceptions here, and thank God a few of them exist, particularly number one, official compensation. I'm a public official, Keith's a public official. We both receive compensation for the job that we do. It's the only reason why I get that compensation is but for holding public office, my employer pays me. And if it wasn't for this exception, the official compensation exception, I'd be violating Oregon law every time I took a paycheck from the state of Oregon. Which is really kind of the reciprocal to say that, you know, anybody that takes money from a local government without there being a legal, lawful process for that transfer of money to them, whether it's official compensation or reimbursement of expenses, not only could that be considered embezzlement, it's also going to be a violation of use of office provision. Allowable gifts, which tonight we're not going to talk about gifts, just because we don't have enough time to really get into that. If you'd like to have me come back and talk more about that in another night, happy to do so. But understand that sometimes as elected officials or public officials, we get something of value, a gift, and the only reason why we're getting that is because we hold public office. But post 9/11, a lot of restaurants said, if you're a public safety officer, police and fire, you eat for free. Come on in and have lunch. You remember that? That violates this rule on the surface, because the only reason why they're getting that free lunch is because they're public safety officers. And frankly, the practice existed long before that, with police officers in particular, inner city Detroit, New York, a lot of establishments would give police officers free meals because they liked having that local government or that local law enforcement presence. And so, you know, those lunches would violate this unless it was otherwise an allowable gift. And I'm going to tell you that, again, we're not going to get into the gift rules on this, but a lot of those sorts of things I just explained would not be allowable gifts. Keith, I saw your hand go up. All right, next rule gets a lot of people in trouble, confidential information. When you're on a city council, maybe meeting an executive session, I generally say that the Las Vegas rule applies to executive sessions. Everybody knows the Las Vegas rule. Or ends up on Facebook. But what happens in executive session really should stay in executive session. You should not be, you know, sharing that with others. And if you gain information, don't use that for your own financial benefit. Because you will be, as an elected official, you'll be on the inside track on a lot of things. You'll know where the next big development is going. You'll know, when I was with the city of Salem as an appointed official, you know, I knew these companies that had code names because they did not want to be known for corporate strategy reasons. But when Sanyo Solar was coming to town, I knew it was Sanyo Solar. Even though we had a code name on it, it was then Project ARC. It was locating in, just north of Mill Creek, not too far from here. You know, I could have gone out and bought a ton of Sanyo Solar stock, knowing that they were about to expand. I clearly would have been violating this rule, had I used that. And in fact, You know, a lot of times, it's not uncommon with economic development deals, you'll be asked to sign a particular ethics non-disclosure, conflict of interest, confidential information agreement, where you're going to agree in writing also not to conduct, you know, to engage that type of behavior. So now, if you did, you violate that agreement, you violate Oregon ethics laws, and you possibly violated a few state and federal criminal laws as well.
Because we're developing 34 complexes, I went to our city attorney, Wally Lee, our mayor and city administrator, Wally wrote me a letter. St. Louis or Staten is off limits for any involvement for me, but am I violating ethics laws by putting assisted living homes and affordable housing in Independence, Portland, Gresham, and 30 other cities, because I am an official here? I have no rule over those cities.
Right, you have no rule over
the
cities. That's right. Yep. And that's the next one, which is representing private interests, which is the other rule that gets people in trouble, is that you cannot represent a private party before your own governing body. So whether you're an accountant, a lawyer, or a developer, you can't show up and lobby your own counsel for that particular decision for the benefit of a client or benefit of something of your own. If you are a member of that body, not only are you on the conflict side of things required to recuse yourself, but also on the professional side of things, you've got to find an intermediary to assist you if it's absolutely imperative that issue be taken to that governing body. Contracts. Another one, if you're serving on a governing body and you approve a contract, then you're ethically prohibited for a period of 2 years, or waiting, a cooling off period, if you will, or a waiting period of 2 years from having any sort of involvement with that contract. So if, for example, and this is one of the advantages, frankly, of having a professionally managed city with a council and manager form of government, is that your city manager, hopefully, you have delegated to him authority to sign most contracts. When I was with the city of Salem, it was not uncommon for me to sign an $8 million contract. Because in one case, I did sign a very large contract for a concrete company that made impervious concrete. And about a year later, one of my city councilors ended up going to work for that company. Had that contract had to go to the city council, that particular councilor would have been denied an employment opportunity, because he would have been put in a position to approve that contract, and the two-year waiting period would have gone into place, and he would not have been able to subsequently go to work for that company. And I think you can all see what this rule is intended to do, is it's intended to prohibit any sort of insider dealing or a lack of impartiality in the approval of contracts, particularly at the federal level, lots of headlines between Boeing and Department of Defense officials, where the Department of Defense officials are signing contracts and then getting these really cushy jobs with Boeing. It happened about a decade and a half ago. And this applies, I said city councilors, this applies to staff too. All those contracts that I approved, I then needed to keep a log of what I was approving. And if I was going to leave the city of Salem, I went to work for another public entity. But in that case, if I decided to go into the private sector, I would have been precluded from taking employment with any of those parties that I'd approved those contracts for at least a period of 2 years. And then finally, conflicts of interest. This is the area, so all of these again are kind of little traps that people are often unaware of when they're working for, running for a local office, or serving on a governing body. And the last one that we're going to talk about is conflicts of interest. As I said at the outset, there are two types of conflicts that exist within our law. Both of them, like the other rules, are very much focused on finances, decisions that would be or could be to an elected official or the decision maker's financial benefit or financial detriment. And the difference between these two is the degree of certainty of that financial benefit or detriment. So I'm going to repeat what I just said a little bit differently, talking about each type. Actual conflicts of interest. Actual conflicts of interest exist whenever a public official is about to make a decision, take an action, or make a recommendation. Actually, I shouldn't say elected official, it's really any public official making a decision, or a recommendation that would be to their financial benefit or detriment then it's an actual conflict of interest. We compare that and contrast that with what's called a potential conflict of interest, which is the same wording, a decision, action, or recommendation, only now it could be to the person's financial benefit or detriment. And note, it cuts both ways. It's not always decisions that put money in your pocket, but it's also decisions that would have you paying money out of your pocket. And if faced with an actual conflict of interest, what the law requires, and Mayor, this is going to be the answer to your question you asked in between the two sessions, with an actual conflict of interest, if you're an appointed official on a commission or an elected official on a governing body, you must declare the conflict on the record. You must state with specificity the nature of that conflict, and then you must recuse.
And the conflict has financial gain or detriment.
What's that?
It's a conflict that has financial gain or detriment.
It definitely would, yes.
Would or could.
Would or, well, no. We're just going to deal with the actual right now. Mm-hmm. So one that would result in a financial gain or detriment, you, and we'll talk about the you piece in a minute, you have to disclose it fully on the record. And you don't just say, sorry, I got an actual conflict of interest. What you have to do is say, I have an actual conflict of interest because I do business with the applicant that's about to appear with us tonight. He's a business partner of mine. If I make this decision favorably, it's going to make money for both of us. If I make this decision unfavorably, then we're going to lose money. And because of that, I can't participate tonight. I'm sorry, Mayor. I'm now going to be recused from this. May the record please reflect the nature of my disclosure and the fact that I'm recusing myself. You have to go through that and really put it all out there and put it in the record. And the reason for that is twofold. One, in the interest of public transparency, we want to see that so the public knows what's going on. The other reason is by putting it in the record and stating it so fully on the, in the meeting, then it insulates the decision from a subsequent appeal, that there was some sort of a bias or ex parte conflict or contact or any other possible grounds for appeal, which if you've been around land use long enough, you know that there are hundreds of grounds for appeal.
Really, my concern on the real specific, which I'm not going to give you any details, but do I have to accept that recusal?
Yes. So unless you have a council rule, and I looked at your charter, and I don't see a mandatory participation rule, any member of your governing body can elect not to participate. Yes. And Keith, is there a mandatory participation rule in council rules? Yeah, I didn't see one. So, yeah.
Okay.
Some councils do. Some councils have what's called a mandatory participation rule that says unless you otherwise are biased or have an actual conflict of interest, you must participate in the decision. Mm-hmm. But that's rare. Mm-hmm. You generally don't see that.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yep.
So this actual one is like you're 100% going to either lose money or make money.
That's right.
Then you have to recuse yourself.
You have to recuse.
It's
after
not
fully
possibly if I talk to this person tomorrow and made a deal, then I would make money. Maybe.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. It's not a maybe situation. It's an actual situation. And you recuse yourself after making the disclosure. I'm going to tell you in my experience, it's the failure to fully disclose that gets most people in trouble. They recuse. We see people doing lots of recusals, but they're just, I'm abstaining. You know, they sat through the whole hearing, and they're sitting there, and it's time to vote, and they're like, I abstain. Well, why are you abstaining? They don't say. That's not adequate under Oregon ethics law. You have to fully disclose and recuse at the outset of the proceeding before the decision is even under deliberation and discussion.
Maybe silly, but I want to make cover all bases. Mm-hmm. We passed a 3% local gas tax.
Ah, great question. Go ahead. I'm going with this.
Obviously, as a city councilor, I voted in favor of the tax. I thought it should have been more. It's raised money to pave streets and
sure.
Other things. We had a conflict. I mean, according to this,
absolutely.
We as county council mayor had a conflict there. Because it's, in this case, detrimental to our finance.
But it affected everyone.
But it affected everyone. I mean,
that's right.
There are a couple times like this has come up.
So
stormwater fees and things like that.
Excellent issue spotting. And absolutely excellent issue spotting. I was going to say, you know, how many of you served on council have made a decision that was a when you faced an actual conflict of interest? And everybody's hand should go up. If you've ever voted on a rate increase, a tax, anything that was going to affect yourself, then yes, absolutely, you had an actual conflict of interest there. And there are some conflict exceptions where these rules, the announcement and the disclosure and recusal rule, don't come into place. One is if the nature of your conflict is due to a membership requirement which we're not going to get into, because that very rarely comes up with city councilors. It kind of comes up with people that are serving on certain state boards and commissions. Like if I'm an attorney and I'm serving on the state board of board of governors for the state bar, and I'm now going to make some rule that's going to affect me in the way I practice law, well, I'm actually there because I'm an attorney. I get a pass on that. There's also what's called a class exception. If the financial impact of the decision is along a broad class of individuals, like the voters of a community, then you get a pass on that too. Because otherwise, government would grind to a standstill and wouldn't be able to make those kinds of decisions, right? The key thing to know, though, is under Oregon law, this class exception, there's only one group and one group only that can declare a class exception, and that's the Oregon Ethics Commission, which we're not going to get into the role of the commission too much tonight in the interest of time. But understand that if you're a public official or even a candidate for office, and you have a question about these ethics rules, you can pick up the phone and there's staff people there Monday through Friday at 8 to 5 that are going to give you guidance, take down your name, not in a bad way, make a record and listen to what you have to say and then give you guidance. And when it comes to this class exception, if you're really paranoid about it, you can ask for a class determination by the Oregon Government Ethics Commission to look at your set of circumstances and say, yes, indeed, we think a class exists. Now, practically, I've not seen that happen very often. It happens from time to time. Most city councils, most county commissions will just roll through with the vote because they know that if a complaint were to come in and I had a conflict of interest, a class will be found on the back end of that complaint. Now, you go through the pain and the trouble of going through the complaint, which is unfortunate in and of itself. But I also think that most people, you know, most residents, they get, yeah, there are going to be certain types of decisions. In fact, it was said even before I got to this slide that when you voted for that rate increase, well, that affected everybody. So, of course, there has to be an exception for that, right? Well, yes, indeed, there it is. But good. If you're looking at your decisions and you start seeing these actual conflicts of interest, then that tells me you get it. Actual conflict. It's not just the decision maker, by the way, that we have to concern ourselves about. It's also any relative, if the decision would be to the financial benefit or detriment of a relative or a business with which you or a relative is associated. So we start to cast a pretty wider net as to who may be affected by the decision. Hypothetical, I'm a property owner, resident, and behind me is undeveloped property. My backyard borders upon property that is now subject to an annexation and a rezone from agricultural to residential. What do you think? And now I'm a member of the Planning Commission or a member of the City Council, and I'm being asked either in an appeal or an initial application to either approve or deny this annexation, and which probably going to go to voting people anyways, but the annexation, and if annexed, an automatic rezone. You tell me. Run through the analysis. Do I have an actual conflict of interest?
Right, but the annexation probably wouldn't create a conflict of interest. You may depreciate the value of your property eventually if they put a prison or something. But expect, you know, on the face of it, a annexation of property just puts property within the boundary of the city's safe limits and allows something to happen to that property. You don't know if that's good, bad, or indifferent, or it may lay on a map. Property in the city limits here that hasn't developed for decades.
Right. So, would it result? What's that?
It could.
If it's a could. And if it's a could, then it's a potential conflict of interest. Yeah. And with a potential conflict of interest, the thing to note here is that announcement rule still applies. This I see violated time and time again, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Because people just don't understand. They get so focused on actual conflicts of interest and the rules surrounding that, to get that right, they forget that, hey, when it comes to a potential, because the bottom line is you still get to participate when it's a potential conflict of interest, they think, oh, it's no big deal, I can just sit here and move along. And the answer to that is no. You have to still declare the conflict, and you must do so with a reasonable amount of specificity as to put the public on notice as to what your conflict is. Once you've done so, then you can fully participate in the discussion and the vote on the matter that's before you. But again, you must disclose. So in that hypothetical I gave you, I'd say I'm a counselor, Sean O'Day. Want everybody to know here tonight that the applicant that's come here before us is on a piece of, or the application's on a piece of property. It's borders my backyard. If this approves, a whole bunch of houses go in there. I don't know, maybe it increases my value, maybe it doesn't, maybe it decreases my value, maybe it doesn't. And it's going to be subject to a vote of the people anyways, subject to a state law, which we won't get into that. And so we don't know if this property is coming into the city limits or not. And so based on those facts, I've got a potential conflict of interest. I fully intend on participating in the discussion of the vote tonight. Please let the record reflect what I just said. And you're good to go. But you need to, again, disclose with a degree of specificity. You just can't say, oh, it's a neighboring property, I've got a potential conflict, but I'm gonna vote anyways. That's generally not enough. You need to give a little bit more detail there to alert the public. And the people often ask me, well, why? Well, why is that, Sean? Why is it that the law requires that? Again, it's the interest of transparency so that the public can have faith in the integrity of the decisions that you're making. You need to let that all be known and then give them a chance either to agree or disagree, either by choosing to file a complaint or not file a complaint on the back end of that decision if you got the analysis wrong.
So Ditto doesn't cover it for the rest of the council. Because I'll always go first and declare, I'm a member of my own property inside, da 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 da. I think
the Ditto is fine. I mean, if there's
the
no
rest
other.
Of the council, the yeah. rest of the council can just go Ditto.
They can say, I have the same potential conflict yeah. as Councillor
Ronquist
for the same reasons he said. And if there's any sort of additional information about that, yes.
How do you define a relative, and how far does that extend?
Great question. It extends. Great segue. The lawyer is taking too long to talk. I'm going to ask a question. So long. Good on you. So, a relative is a spouse, any children, or spouse's children. Whether they are your natural-born children or not, siblings, spouses of siblings, parents or spouses' parents, any person for whom the public official candidate has a legal support obligation, any individual for whom the public official provides benefits arising from their public employment, or from the public official candidate receives benefits arising from that individual's employment. Bottom line is anybody with whom you share a domestic sort of partnership or anybody that is in a familial-type relationship is considered family under Oregon. Very broad definition. And if you have any questions about a particular individual, again, I'm going to say, keep in mind, we're not intending to make you subject matter experts here today, really just familiarize you with the rules so you know enough to know when to ask for help, when to call a friend, and again, that friend is going to be the Ethics Commission staff. You pick up the phone, that's what they're there for. Your local governments, including the Council of Governments, we all pay an assessment to fund the local government Ethics Commission. So it's a resource that's there for public officials to use.
It's that verbiage that cost me 4 planning commission members about 8 years ago. They lightened it up considerably in our annual reporting.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah, on the statement of economic interest.
Yeah.
Yep, which we're not going to talk about that later, but yes.
But that's what it said, and I got resignations right across the board.
Yeah. Resignations or recusals?
Resignations.
Oh, because of the statement of economic interest.
Yeah.
The SEI forms, that was a little bit different. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, they fixed it.
They did. The legislature went back and corrected that.
Yeah.
Who's a member of the household? Again, any person who resides with you or the candidate. Incidentally, I've been really focused because of the makeup of the audience today on what you do if you're a volunteer member of a commission or board or an elected official. If you're an appointed official with a conflict of interest, because these rules apply to you there as well, what do you do? Keith, do you know the answer? If you ended up with a conflict of interest, what your ethical responsibilities are?
You can recuse yourself from the matter. Have a staff member handle it.
Yep, have a staff member handle it. That's exactly what happens. And the law requires you, your disclosure requirement is to notify your supervisor, or in this case, as a city manager, it would be a governing body, the full city council. I had to do this. My ex-spouse actually worked for a local government auditing firm. We were married at the time. And that contract came up for renewal with the city of Salem. I had purchasing authority, signature authority for Salem at that time. I sent an email to my boss and said, my spouse works for this business. It is now up for renewal. If I approve this, it will be to that business's benefit. Which is a business with which I'm associated because of her employment there. I can't approve this contract. I'm going to send it to you to decide what you want to do. That's how practically that gets handled. And the key is as the official, appointed official, paid employee, not member of a governing body or commission, is to pass it up the chain, not down the chain. So if you have a conflict of interest, you notify your supervisor, you notify your governing body, they will practically send it to a subordinate or somebody else to handle, because that has to happen, if they don't handle it themselves. But it's not okay to send it down the chain. If you send those things down the chain, there could be the appearance of impropriety. You're now directing that subordinate in how to handle that matter. Now, what's a business with which a person is associated? I'm not going to walk through all the eaches and everys of this. As you can see, it's a very long definition. Suffice it to say that a business is anything that makes money, or even certain nonprofits could be considered a business, although we do have some exceptions, nonprofit exceptions. A business is not another local government entity, by the way. So I had a counselor, a city counselor, whose husband is the operations manager for Chariots, the local transit district in Salem. And the city of Salem city council would vote on giving money to Chariots quite regularly. And the question arose one day, hey, does Counselor Dickey have a conflict here because her husband is an employee of the transit district and she's voting tonight on whether or not to give the transit district money? Isn't that a business with which she's associated? And the answer came back, no, because governments aren't business. So there is a little bit of an exception there when it comes to government entities, but that only applies to other local governments. Yeah.
Mutual funds. I have no idea if a mutual fund has small stake in sort of, you know, has anything to do with Keith buying toilet paper or something for
right.
City Hall. I don't know any of this. We don't need to worry about Nation if we just own a mutual fund that you even know what Fidelity has.
I think that's right, but again, most of the decisions, the good news for you, are being handled by your professional paid staff. Quick war story, up the road, Mount Angel. Really unfortunate set of circumstances. Mount Angel, very small community. It does have a city manager, but before it had a city manager, it had a practice of the council approving the payment of all bills, including the local power bill. Just so happened that the mayor was an employee of the power company and voted to approve the payment of that bill. A regular bill that the city would have had to pay anyways. Well, somebody got angry with the mayor, and guess what they did? They filed an ethics complaint. Said he had a conflict of interest. For the last 3 years, once a month, he would vote to put money from the city coffers into the bank account of his employer. Guess what the Ethics Commission did? They found a violation, but they issued a letter of correction. He didn't have to pay a fine. But it was, indeed, a conflict of interest. That mayor should not have been voting on that matter because it was a business with which he was associated. So again, a trap for the unwary. Tips from the field, war stories, is that if you don't, and I'm not sure what the practice is in your city, but generally speaking, if you're a council manager from the government, you don't need to be approving bills on the council agenda. If you have that there, get it off. Save yourself the time and save yourself the potential headache of an ethics violation because it's just simply not needed. Your city manager has the authority to sign those checks and authorize the payment of those bills. That's why you hired a city manager. Mount Angel no longer approves the payment of bills on a monthly basis before their city council. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that different than, say, the same situation if they're on the budget committee and they're approving the budget that may pay that power company?
Yes.
Then they should not be voting on that portion?
So in my own mind, and keep in mind, I'm saying this as a local government official, COG, executive director, that's my capacity here tonight. I'm not saying this as an ethics commission member. That's really not saying it as a lawyer, because I'm not your lawyer. My mind tells me I need to noodle through the law a little bit more, but maybe a potential on that one because of a budget committee. But certainly you've spotted the right issue. And what I would do if I was advising that budget committee member is say, pick up the phone and call the ethics commission staff. Mm-hmm. Tell them your relationship. Get their advice. Get their guidance. Because that gives you certain safe harbors. We get in the full ethics class. We talk about the role of the ethics commission and staff and the safe harbor it provides. But again, for purposes of tonight, just know you've got that safety line. That's who you want to reach out to. All right, what's a business? The declaration. Again, we've talked about this. You must declare the conflict prior to abstaining or recusing, not afterwards. have to do so at the beginning of the proceeding, not at the end of it. And you must explain the nature of that conflict. When it comes to appointed officials, written notice to your boss, the appointing authority, and passing that conflict up the chain is what's required. There are certain exceptions to the conflicts. We've already talked about one of them, the class exemption. There's also, I've alluded to a few times, we've got an exception for nonprofits. So long as you're not an executive director of a nonprofit or otherwise being paid, if you're a member of a nonprofit or a board member of a nonprofit, you can vote on matters that would benefit that nonprofit. Kind of give you the bottom line up front. That's how that works, but I'm again going to tell you that if you find yourself in that circumstances where you're voting on a matter that involves a nonprofit of which you are a member or a board member or somehow affiliated, that maybe you're a member of the Chamber of Commerce. The Chamber of Commerce has come to the council to seek a grant of some sort. Then I would say pick up the phone, call the Ethics Commission, run through the analysis with the staff just to make sure that you take advantage of this particular exception. And again, I've said it, and I'd like to begin with one of the most important points and end with one of the most important points, and that is don't feel like you need to be experts in this. You do have resources available to you. You've got your city attorney. You can always feel free to give me a call. I'm happy to help walk you through the issue, help build the vocabulary and the awareness so that you can then in turn give the Ethics Commission staff a phone call. And actually, subject to any sort of conflicts that I might have with my new role as an ethics commissioner, we will, and if I can't help you, I'll get you in touch with other people who can. We'll get you some help so that you can then make an informed and educated call to the Ethics Commission staff to get the guidance that you need so that you can stay out of trouble. And understand, again, that this is not intended to be a gotcha game. That's not the purpose of these laws. The purpose of these laws is to help build the public's faith and confidence in the integrity of the decisions that we're making, that they're being made, not because of financial interests or ulterior motives, but instead of being made based upon the best judgment and wisdom that you were elected to office to exercise. That concludes my presentation tonight. Happy to stick around, answer any questions that you guys might have. Otherwise, I'll turn the floor back to Keith for the mayor. Any other questions? All right. Campaign contributions. So if you're running for office, the second mandatory reading is a publication that the Secretary of State's office puts out that discusses campaign contributions. And campaign contributions gets into the area of ethics called gifts, and contributions are an exception to the gift rules. The gift law, just so that you're all aware of it, is you can't accept anything greater than $50 value in a calendar year from any source that has a legislative or administrative interest in you, whether you're an appointed official or an elected official. And that's a lot to work through, right? How big is, what's the gift? It's anything of value, including food, travel, anything that's provided in kind. It's not always just, you know, an object. That could be a service that's provided to you for free that exceeds that $50 threshold. And it's from a prohibited source, which is one that has an administrative or legislative interest in you, which for most elected officials is just about anybody, because people care about what you're going to vote on. But one of the exceptions to that are campaign contributions. And there are a whole host of exceptions. Once you've ran through that and identified it as a gift, then you need to see, does it meet an exception that would allow you to take it? So there you got kind of gifts, very high level on the rules there. But it, again, you know, there are two types of elected officials, two types of public officials. Some might say those that are ethical and those that aren't. I basically divide it a little bit differently and say those that will accept gifts and those that just decided at the outset of their public careers, I'm not going to accept any gifts. Hence the bumper sticker, don't take anything from anybody, you'll be okay, which is really an overreach, and that's, you don't have to live your life by that rule, but I know many public officials who do. They won't even accept a cup of coffee from somebody else for fear of you know, running afoul of the gift rules. On the other side of it, though, if you are a public official that's going to accept gifts, then my best advice is keep a gift log. Who gave you what, when, document the nature of the interest that they may have had so that you could substantiate later on if there's ever a complaint that you didn't receive more than $50 worth of value from that particular source. And the source analysis gets a little complicated as well. You know, when you think of a source as being a person, but who's really paying it for the person? Is it their employer? Is it somebody else? You know, do the lobbyists get in the picture? It can get a little complicated. But again, if you'd like to have me back, I'm happy to come back and talk about gifts in more depth, or the Ethics Commission has some really good online training modules that you can sit through. And again, if you're running for office, I encourage you to do that. Sit through the conflicts, sit through the gifts, and really get a little bit more, a higher degree of fidelity in the rules and the concepts we talked about tonight.
Here's a sticky link. Well, I'm personal friends with the executive director of the local Pacific Power, his wife happens to work with the city. Two councils I know of have been invited to. I went over to the house a year ago for dinner, which was well before anything came up to the council there. I've since turned down obligations, and turned down invitations, even though they're friends, to their house for dinner, and turned down beers and bulkings and things with them, just because if you don't accept a gift from anybody, it's easier that way.
It is.
But then if they're friends and you go to the house for dinner, which I've not done since before they came to council, how does that all stick out?
Yeah, so, you know, the ethics rules once allowed my then spouse to avoid giving me a birthday gift, a Christmas gift, because she was a business that did business with the city, was an employee of the business, did business with the city. She said, sorry, Charlie, I don't have to give you a gift now. Because if I did, I would ethically be violating, you know, the gift rules, which then got lightened up. And at one point, actually, she wasn't wrong. I mean, that was an actual application, including, you know, at children's birthday parties where one family would give the child another birthday gift. And it turned out that, you know, that the one family was in private sector and was doing business with the public entity of which one of the parents was employed by. And then the ethics law, there were some revisions back in 2007, 2000, if I got it right, 2009, that really went a little bit too far. That's when the statement of economic interest fiasco kerfuffle happened. And then the legislature corrected quite a bit of this. I tell you that story not only just to dodge answering your question, but to really kind of get to the point, and that is call the Ethics Commission.
Like, in all of those, in all those cases, except under business ways,
then it's easier. That's right.
But if you want to, by the
way. Right, but if you want to, call the Ethics Commission and run through the analysis with them. And frankly, things like that, you know, when my spouse said, you know, ethically, I can't give you a gift today, Sean, for your birthday, which happens to be on Friday.
So Sean, what do you want for your birthday?
Yeah, right, exactly. Can't accept any gifts. you know, when people started calling the Ethics Commission saying, is this how this rule really works? My daughter won a contest that the local Chamber of Commerce had sponsored. She got free symphony. I didn't know she applied for this. It was some sort of writing contest. She was selected, and I was the deputy city manager at the time. And seven-year-old girl, I told her she couldn't go to the concert because we couldn't accept those tickets under the law that existed. Mm-hmm. I called the Ethics Commission and said, yeah, sorry, man, you're right. You've got to turn those tickets back. And thank you for bringing this to our attention, because it's circumstances like that that help inform the law, help inform the legislature so we can reform the law so it doesn't have absurd results like that. So, again, bottom line, you know, pick up the phone, call the Ethics Commission, work with the staff, run your circumstances through that, and then rely upon the advice they give you. All right, Keith.
I actually have a meeting with Sean on Friday, so now I've gotten out of giving him a gift. like it's sort of paper private. Sean is sincerely one of my favorite people to talk to. I always learn something. I appreciate his thought process, his wisdom, his experience, his background. I appreciate him coming here tonight. I appreciate all of you coming here tonight as well. So thank you very much. And please feel free to ask staff or Sean any questions you have as you go. Thanks.